Good morning, students. I'm Dr. Suhas Sabnis, and we are going to discuss today one important aspect in thin film interference. And the point that I've mentioned and taken for today's lecture is interference due to reflected light in parallel thin films. The question is, why parallel thin films? If this aspect is clear, then the rest of the discussion becomes much easier. When I say thin films, it does mean here that the films which are having minimum width. When I say the films are parallel, I do mean that I have removed chromatic aberration, spherical aberration, or any other sort of aberration from the top surface and from the bottom surface, from both sides, so that I get a film which is uniform in terms of density, parallel in terms of appearance. There is no density variance. The entire surface is a very thin surface, unaberrated surface, which is parallel to itself. Now, by this assumption that I have taken a parallel thin film, many complications that may arrive due to density aberrations, due to thickness aberrations, due to any other sort of aberrations that are present normally in any glass plate, are systematically avoided here, and we don't have to consider these particular aberrations while calculation for the constructive and destructive interference is concerned. We know the interference. Interference is nothing but when two waves arrive at a point, they assimilate at a point, which is the property of the waves. Waves assimilate, waves interfere, and that unique property of interference, it is as general as, you know, some properties of the wave, if I can explain: interference, diffraction, polarization, dispersion. These are unique properties of waves. Mass, okay, then density, velocity associated with that mass, we mean that momentum. These are unique properties of particles. So, we have some unique properties of waves explored over here, and first property in that is property of interference, and we are going to test this property against very ideal surfaces like a parallel thin film. Now, what are the constraints? The constraint is that I can observe this interference from the reflected side, that is on this side, or I can observe the interference on this side. Okay? So, these are the two constraints with which we can discuss these cases. The first case is being taken for today's lecture. So, once again, we'll look into the heading. It is interference due to reflected light in parallel thin films. Now, I already drawn the diagram for you in order to save the time. Let us have a discussion on the diagram, rather the discussion regarding this particular diagram, how the entire interference across the entire range of the film is taking place. Now, see here, SA is the incident ray. Again, I repeat, SA is the incident ray. The incident ray makes an angle I with the direction of normal at point A. The incident ray, SA, makes an angle I with the direction of normal at point A. I will be called as angle of incidence. Okay. Now, the intensity division is taking place at point A. The ray is partially reflected in the direction AR1. Just see here. The same ray is partially reflected in the direction AR1 and it is refracted in the direction AB. Of course, whenever there is a change in the density, the light will change its course of, you know, traversing. It will come closer to the normal. So, it is refracted in the direction AB, it will make certain angle with the direction of normal at point A, correct? That angle is R here. R is called angle of refraction. Then, from point B, again the ray is internally reflected in the direction BC. See here, it is coming in the direction AB, this is refracted path, and it is internally reflected in the direction BC. And from point C, it is taking the exit path CR2. From point B, it is transmitted in the direction BT. Okay. Now, we need certain constructions in order to come and arrive at the conclusions of the interference in terms of constructive and destructive, you know, analytics to be carried out over here. So, what are these constructions? I draw AM normal to BC. See here again, AM normal to BC. Again, we can focus more over here. Just see here, CN, this is perpendicular to AR1. CN perpendicular to AR1. And then produce BC in the backward direction. Produce BC in the backward direction so that it meets the extended normal to point A at point B. So that it meets the extended normal to point A at point B. Our given surface is TT and T dash T dash. This is my given thin film, parallel thin film. Mu is the refractive index of the thin film, and outside the thin film we have absolute air medium present. So if you give this description, you will get complete mark for this particular derivation. It is generally asked for complete 7 marks. So once again revisit this particular description that I have given so that in one go you understand what is to be written for this particular diagram. You need to draw a neatly labeled diagram as I have drawn over here, and after that the discussion will be going as I am discussing right now. Okay. Consider a parallel thin film enclosed by the surfaces TT and T dash T dash. SA is the incident ray. The incident ray makes an angle I with the direction of normal at point A. I is called as angle of incidence. From point A, the ray is reflected in the direction AR1 and it is refracted in the direction AB. The refracted ray AB makes an angle R with the direction of normal at point A. R will be called as angle of refraction. From point B, the ray is internally reflected in the direction BC and it is taking this transmitted path BT, and from point C, it is once again taking the exit path in the direction CR2. What is our intention? The intention is to find out the path difference between the rays AR1 and CR2. For this, we need some constructions to be made. What are these constructions? We draw AM perpendicular to BC, we draw CN perpendicular to AR1, and then produce BC in the backward direction so that it meets the extended normal to point A at point P. Okay? So if you write this particular description for this particular diagram, you will get full marks. Now let us go for the derivation for this particular diagram. Now this is for calculation of the path difference. So I will mention that calculation of path difference. Calculation of path difference. How do we calculate the path difference? Now, generally, path difference, I will say here, path difference is equal to path in glass into RI of glass minus path in air into RI of air. This is my definition. Now see here, the ray which has, you know, SA, we have considered it as an incident ray. The ray has already started its journey as reflected path in the direction AR1 from air into the air. Okay, but then consider this traversing, that is, it is going through while it is passing through this particular thin film, that is AB plus BC. Okay, this traversing is an extra path that it has suffered through the glass plate, and after point C, see here, the ray CR2 and the ray AR1 are again parallel to each other, but beyond this point N, that's where we have drawn CN normal to AR1. So beyond this, these two rays are parallel to each other. So what would be my extra path traversed in the air? That extra path traversed in the air will be AN. Getting my point? So let's write down this, let's calibrate this. Part difference is called delta. So I'll just make provision here. So this is delta, that is the part difference for the interference is equal to path in glass is AB plus BC. Path in glass is nothing but AB plus BC. I'll write that AB plus BC. Of course, when I say path in glass, it is extra path in the glass because we are referring the path difference. Into array of glass is mu minus path in air. What is the extra path in air? I have just discussed that extra path in air is AN. So AN, and what will be the array of air? It is 1. So this will be my equation number 1. So formulation starts over here. Okay. Now, we need to substitute some values. So further, development in this particular derivation will be made. I consider two triangles here. Okay. I consider the triangle ANC. Help me here. Consider the triangle ANC. Now, what is sine of I? What is sine I in this particular triangle? Sin I is nothing but AN upon AC. So right here, sin I will be equal to AN upon AC. Now consider this second triangle, AMC. This is also right angle triangle. So consider, I write here, consider the right angle triangle AMC. Okay. Now in this right angle triangle, once again we need to calculate the value of sin R. Help me. What is sin R over here? Sin R is nothing but MC upon AC. Okay. So I'll write here MC, or we'll write CM upon AC. The popular Snell's law is known by us. Let's give cumulatively this as equation number 2. Okay. Now, we know the Snell's law. We'll write here, we know Snell's law. The Snell's law says that mu is equal to sin I upon sin R. Okay. Mu is equal to sin I upon sin R. Let's put the values. Sin I is AN upon AC. And the sin R is nothing but CM upon AC. So what do we get? This AC and AC will get cancelled. We'll get mu is equal to AN upon CM. I need the value of AN in equation number 1. For getting this value of AN, I have done this entire construction over here. Okay. So let's get this value of AN over here. AN will be equal to mu into CM. Give this equation number 3. What will be my next statement here then? My next statement is put for AN in equation 1 from equation 3. Okay. Let's write down put for AN from equation 1 in equation 3. From equation 3, I should say, in equation 1, we get. Now, we will be putting the value of AN as mu into CM in equation 1. Okay. Put that value, what do you get? Delta will be equal to AB plus BC into mu. I refer AN as mu into CM. This is mu into CM. Okay. That does mean that it is AB plus BC minus CM into mu. AB plus BC plus CM minus mu. This will be my equation number 4. See here. This is AB plus BC minus CM. Okay. So, in order to solve this entire aspect, I consider now another triangle, and that triangle is triangle ABP. This is the triangle. Okay. What do you find from this triangle? See here, the base angles are equal. By symmetry, you also find that the entire length is also same. That is, length AB is equal to length PB. This property is for the triangle which is known as isosceles triangle. So, my triangle ABP is an isosceles triangle. Okay. So, I write here in triangle ABP by property, I just write by property, don't have to write entire thing that it is an isosceles triangle, that is the basic property. We all know that this is studied in the 9-10 standard, we know all these things. So, in this we have got AB is equal to PB. This is what I get. This is my equation number 5. Okay. Now, put the value of AB, okay, in this equation number 4 as PB from 5. That's what I will be writing. Put for AB in equation 4 from equation 5. What do we get? We get here delta will be equal to AB is equal to PB. So, I get PB plus BC minus CM into mu. Just refer the diagram and help me here. See here, PB plus BC minus CM. What do you get? See here, PB plus BC minus CM. It does mean I get the value PM. Okay. So, I write this as delta is equal to PM into mu. This is my equation number 6. This is my equation number 6. Okay. Simultaneously, you will be noting entire things so that the derivation is completed within minimum time here. Now, I remove this part because I need some space over here. So, this part I am removing. I hope you have written this. Now, see here, I have got delta is equal to PM into mu. For accommodating this PM, I have another bigger triangle to state. See here, PMA, or I will say AMP, which is also a right angle triangle. Okay. So, I write here, consider the right angle triangle AMP. Now, in this right angle triangle, help me, what is cos of R? Cos of R is nothing but PM upon AP. PM upon AP. I am interested in calculation of this PM value. So, my PM will be AP cos of R. AP cos of R. So, what is AP? Now, this distance is thickness, and this, let us refer this thickness as T. Then, this thickness by symmetry will also be equal to T. Okay. So, what do I get here? This is nothing but T plus T cos of R. It does mean 2T cos of R. This is my value for PM. PM is equal to 2t cos of R. Okay. Let us put this value of PM in equation 6. Let us say that PM equation is referred as equation 7. What will be my statement once again? Put for PM from equation 7 in equation 6. We get here for delta, I'll put the value of PM as 2t cos of R. So, 2t cos of R into mu. Rearrange this. That is 2 mu t cos of R. I've got one statement for delta over here. Okay. Now, see here. This delta refers as path difference between the rays AR1 and CR2. Okay. But this is analytically calculated. Now, if we try to calculate the same thing in terms of presence of the bright and the dark spots, as we find in our observation, Then analytical treatment says that delta should be equal to n lambda for constructive interference, and delta should be equal to 2n plus minus 1 lambda by 2 for the destructive interference. That's very normally known. Okay, but then if we compare that with the value of delta, we'll be exactly getting the reverse of it. Means experimentally, wherever I need to get the value of the bright spot, I am getting a dark spot, and wherever I need to get the value of a dark spot, I am getting a bright spot, vice versa. Now, why this is happening? It does mean that some phase correction is involved, some path correction is involved. Where this path correction is involved? The path correction is involved at point A. So, at point A, according to electromagnetic theory of light, that whenever there is a reflection on the surface of a denser film, there is a path difference of lambda by 2 or phase difference of pi introduced. It does mean that if it is coming with a crest, it will go with a trough. It will coming with a trough, it will go with a crust. Okay, this electromagnetic theory is only applicable for the case of reflection, and the background has to be a denser background. Keep that in mind. Okay, so whenever the reflection is happening across a denser background, then the reflection consequently follows with a path change of lambda by 2 plus minus lambda by 2 and a phase change of pi. That is not introduced, that is where I will get the entire bright spots termed as dark spots and vice versa. It should not happen. So we need to add this path correction in the value of delta. So if I add that, I get this value of delta with the phase correction. You can write 2 mu t cos of r plus minus lambda by 2. You can write down phase correction or path correction. The reason is phase correction or path correction at point A according to electromagnetic theory of light. According to electromagnetic theory of light. So, this is my final path difference. This was equation number 7. So, this will be equation number 8, and this will stand as equation number 9 for me. Now, we need to apply the entire thing for cases. What are my cases? Delta has to be equal to n lambda, and for constructive interference and delta has to be equal to 2n plus minus 1 lambda by 2 for destructive interference. But what is my value of delta? That is, delta is 2 mu t cos of r plus minus lambda by 2. Equate it. So what will be my case 1? Case 1 will be for constructive interference. So I will be putting the value of delta as n lambda. So what will be my value of delta? 2 mu t cos of r plus minus lambda by 2 is equal to n lambda. This will be the statement. Correct? Now, take this lambda by 2 on the other side. I get 2 mu t cos of r is equal to n lambda plus minus lambda by 2. If we add, the final statement will be 2 mu t cos of r will be equal to 2n plus minus 1 lambda by 2. Now, this will be my case for the constructive interference, the rule for the constructive interference in case of parallel thin films and reflected case. Now, extend it for the destructive interference. If I extend it for the destructive interference, I will get here delta is equal to 2n plus minus 1 lambda by 2, but my value of delta is again 2 mu t cos of r plus minus lambda by 2. If I put that value, I get 2 mu t cos of r plus minus lambda by 2 is equal to 2n plus minus 1 lambda by 2. Okay? Now, solve this. I get 2 mu t cos of r plus minus lambda by 2 is equal to 2n into lambda by 2. That would be n lambda. Okay? And plus minus lambda by 2. Help me here. What will get cancelled? This lambda by 2 and this plus minus lambda by 2 will get cancelled. The final outcome is 2 mu t cos of r is equal to n lambda. Of course, what will be my equation number? The last equation number was 9. Cumulatively, let us say by analytical treatment, this is my equation number 10. This will be my equation number 11 and this will be my equation number 12. So, 2 mu t cos of r is equal to 2n plus minus 1 lambda by 2 is the rule for the constructive interference here, case for constructive interference, and the case for the destructive interference is 2 mu t cos of r is equal to n lambda. Okay? So, the entire question starts from drawing the diagram, giving the explanation for the diagram, starting with the definition of the path difference, and then continuing the derivation to get the value of delta, then saying that there is a phase correction or path correction involved, introducing the path correction and getting the corrected value of delta, and finally introducing the analytical treatment delta is equal to n lambda and delta is equal to 2n plus minus 1 lambda by 2 to finally get these two statements as equation number 11 and equation number 12. We do that. This is the complete derivation for interference due to reflected light in parallel thin films. I hope students you understood this entire thing. This is very important for the examination. Thank you. Thanks a lot.